Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And the sultry sounds of the Paul Reiser Orchestra, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Right off the bat, that costs extra money. I want you to know that. That little string thing, thousands of dollars. But we do it for you. Why? Because this is a special, ladies and gentlemen. It's a special. We do special things. If it was a regular, we wouldn't knock ourselves out like that. But it's a special. This is very exciting. This is just, it's just great. Being back in New York in the Fab Palladium, as we are. How are you? You're going to be seeing my ass for a good deal of time, but that's... What can I do? Later in the show, I'll turn around and I'll do jokes just for you, and the hell with them. That's my attitude. Nice to see. This is very exciting, the Palladium, and this is right where I grew up. I grew up three blocks down on 14th Street there, and with that family over there. In fact, these were all my entire floor right here. That's 10B, 10J, and 10... This used to be the Academy of Music, and it was like great concert hall, and great, and then it was old theater. This is where I saw The Sound of Music. This was all Austria years ago. This was all Austria. We had to knock it down for this, but this is a great theater, not a great neighborhood, which is fun to watch people get dressed up and then sprint into the lobby. You never see that. You see people just about 3 seconds from a cab into the lobby. You know, it's funny, but most people, when they go to their old neighborhoods, they always talk about, gee, it's all gone downhill. Gee, it used to be so great, and now look at it. Look what's happened to this neighborhood. And that's what's really terrific about 14th Street. It was never good. It was never good. So you come back years later and you go, you know, this is just about right. This is good. We've maintained a certain level of crap that a lot of neighborhoods can't sustain, and that's nice. It was never good. Even years ago, Indians would say, where are you living? 14th Street. Ooh, yeah. Not a great area. Nice theater, beautiful theater, no question about that. But you got to sprint from your teepee. That's the big problem there. it's great, because I always make the same problem. See, I come back to the area, and I call. I never learn. I come back, I see all my friends. I call up my friends. I go, hey, listen, I'm in town for 2 days. Let's get together. We'll have lunch. We'll have dinner. You have to plan a meal. I don't know where this rule came into effect. But you cannot call a friend without there being some meal lined up. It's like, oh, what time, 11? Well, what meal would that be? I got to know. Is that breakfast? It's not even lunch yet. That's you want to make it 12? You have to have at least a hot beverage and a muffin. You need something. You know why you need food? I figured it out. It's because in case the conversation drags, you have something to do. You have a little piece of business. You can go, ooh, that's good coffee. You know what I mean? You have something to kick open the conversation. You always have hot beverage, a muffin, coffee. Coffee is a great thing to have because it's a quick conversation. You meet a friend, you got half an hour, we'll have coffee. We'll catch up, we'll have coffee. Get together for coffee. That's the only meal that is the name of the food. Coffee. We'll get together for coffee. We know what we're doing and we know what we'll be having. Coffee. You don't even have to want to look at a menu? No, I know what I'll be having. I'll be having coffee. That's why we got together. We got together for coffee. That was advertised, the express purpose of coffee. So I'll have some coffee right now. It's the only food that has that advantage. You can never say, let's get together for lamb. You never say that. Hey, I'm in town. We'll get together for fresca. You never say that. You could have fresca, don't get me wrong. You could have it, but it's not the same draw as coffee. I love coffee. I don't drink coffee, but I love it. I drink tea, and I don't like tea. So that's my life. In a brief nutshell, I continually drink a hot beverage that I actually don't enjoy. It's just, no matter what you do to it, it doesn't get better. That's the sad thing. See, you put sugar, you put cream, you put honey, and you go, ooh, that shit. You know what I mean? It's just... And I know it's not going to be good. Right off the bat, the waitress says, well, how would you like your tea? I won't. I'll tell you that right now. I know that. Why don't you just bring me something in a muffin so I can talk to my friend here, all right? It's not a good beverage. It's not... And that's why there's so many choices. You go into a store, you look at... There's every... Like, hundreds, thousands of teas. You could have every herb and fruit and spice, and they combine them, trying to find some way to make this crap palatable. It's just... And it never gets good. It always sounds promising, doesn't it? You look at it. Ooh, look at this. Apple, cinnamon, mango, cherry tea. That should be good. I like all of those things. This would have to be great. You take it home. Ooh, that's still shit. That's unbelievable. How did they go wrong with that? The other thing, when I come back here, I walk around the old neighborhood and I see people. There are people that I know that I know them, and their names block out. You know, there's a guy, first show came over to me. It was like, I hadn't seen the guy in 10, 12 years, and I said, oh, you ever fake it? You can't come up with a guy's name. And you just, hey, big guy. How you doing, big guy? Hey, sport, how are you, sport? Good to see you. You remember big guy, don't you? This is a big guy. That's his wife, good looking, and it's their daughter, Cupcakes. That's her name. I don't remember names. I remember faces. I always remember the face. You know, you should be introduced by the face. Forget names. Names should be the face. You should whatever it is you remember about that person. Big nose, short pants. Come here a second. This is my buddy, Hawaiian shirt and a bad haircut. You'll remember that. Whatever it is that, you know, catches your attention. Broken glasses, this is food stuck in his teeth. You know, whatever it is. You don't forget that. Years from now, you go, what was that guy's name? Your friend with the spinach, right there. I'll never forget that. There's some people in my life, I never even knew their last names. You just kind of go, hey, how you doing? And people, if anybody refers to them by their last name, I'm confused. It's like, hey, I saw your friend Danny Chandler. Who? Danny. Oh, yeah, sure, Danny. How does that clarify it? That's a mystery to me. It's like half the information, but it's now twice as clear. Oh, Danny, no, I didn't know we had a last name. I thought it was like Flipper, I'll tell you the truth. I thought it was just Danny, you know, like Pele. That's all it was, really? What the hell is it, Chandler? No kidding. Is that new? Did he have that added on? I always get embarrassed because sometimes people come over to me, and even if they're just coming over and they're smiling, I presume I've forgotten their name. And the other thing you do is you go, hey, look, I almost didn't recognize you. What do you gain weight or something? What do you lose weight or something? You put on, what, about 300 pounds? You look different. Something is different. You're a woman now. Is that it? That's what it is. Huh? Oh, I've never met you. Oh, that explains it. Sure. I thought you were a thin guy I went to school with, but you're a heavy woman I never met. That explains it. I always feel this thing. I'm always explaining myself to strangers. I explain things to people who don't even care. Stupid. Do you know this? I don't know why I'm sharing with you. This is very stupid. Do you know that if I want to get change of a dollar, I have to tell the guy why? This is so stupid. Like, I feel like if I don't have a good reason, I won't get the quarters. This is the dumbest. I have to say, can I get change, please? I plan to buy gum. He didn't ask me, but I felt behooved. You know, I walk into a crowded elevator. Could you press 7, please? I'm having lunch with a friend. He didn't ask. Probably deli. You know what I mean? He didn't ask, but I felt. And you kind of have these quick catch-up conversations with friends. Hey, how's everything? Good? Good to see you. Everything's good? So you're good? I'm good. Everything's good? So you're good? I'm good? Good. It's good. It's good that we're all good. Everything is good. Good. Gotta run. You just bombard each other with goods. Just good. Everything is good. You want highlights, maybe. Sometimes you have time for the big highlights. Like, hey, anybody we know of die? No? Good. That's good. Good. Then we're still alive. All right. That's good. Good. You don't want details, you know. Some people give you details and you're truly not interested. I've had an intestinal virus. Oh, would you look at the time? Look at that. I thought I could squeeze in a flu story, but I cannot. Look at the time. It's not that we don't care. See, it's not that we don't care about our friends. We do care, but we don't know what to say to make them feel better. If they have a problem, you know, you go, hey, how's everything? Good? Well, I just lost my job. Oh, yeah, well. Yeah, that's, yeah, but everything else is good? Everything else is good besides the job thing? Family's good? They're all sick. Oh, really? Oh, I shouldn't have asked that. How about you? You're looking good. 3 weeks to live. Oh, really? Give me something. Your coffee. Coffee's good? Good. Good to see the coffee. Good. Got it right. We don't always care. Even when people ask you how you are, they don't always care. They don't. Even if you listen carefully, when people say, how are you? They don't even say, how are you? They go, how are ya? How are ya? How are ya? It's not the same as how are you. How are you is good. How are you is, how are you? You. I'm interested in you. Out of all the people in the world, how is it to be you? That's what concerns me now. You. How are you? How are you is not the same thing. How are you means just say good and go away. Just say good. Register that I asked and then proceed not to tell me. That's what I'm saying. You can't always be nice. You try to be nice. I'm not one of these great chit-chatters. There are people who, God bless them, they can chat. You know what I'm saying? They don't care. They just want a volley. They just want to keep that conversational volley going, you know? And sometimes you can't return the volley. Sometimes, you know, they say something that just doesn't go anywhere. When I was talking to this guy, I said, I was good. I said, you know, how you doing? Where you from? You know, I had a couple of little volleys here. Where you from? I thought that was good. I said, what do you do for a living? I said, what do you do for a living? He says, I manufacture ball bearings. Fine job. I don't make fun of the man. Here's my problem. What the hell do I ask now? Where does that lend itself? You know what I mean? I don't have a lot of ball bearing references to draw from. I You know what I came up with? Oh, really? The round ones or what? That's all I had. Barely skimmed the net there. You know what I mean? I had very little. I had nothing. Because people will talk about things. You bring up a topic and you're in over your head. You don't know what to say. It's like politics. I don't follow politics. I don't really follow current events. But I don't tell people that. See, when somebody brings up a conversation, you never announce, "Whoa, I know nothing about this entire subject. Let me stop you right there. No. I know where you're going with this. It happens all the time. You will feel frustrated and I will feel retarded. So why do it? Why don't we just not do it? Let's pick another subject. How about sports for 40? You want to try that? You never say that. So you kind of, by not saying anything, you have committed. You kind of tiptoe into the conversation there and you just hope it doesn't get too deep, you know? And it always starts off very nice and casual. The guy says, "Hey, well, you see what's going on in Berlin, huh?" And I went, "Yeah." I'm afraid he's going to go, "Okay, what? Oh, I don't know what. I just meant roughly. I didn't mean, yeah, I do. I meant, yeah, no, I don't. That's what I meant. I meant, yeah, no, I don't. No, I don't. Yeah, you tell me. That's what I meant, actually. Why don't you just tell me? And then I know roughly what's going on, but not exactly. You know, I know they tore the wall down. And I don't know why. What are they putting in a playroom or something like that? What are they doing? Some sort of den they're constructing for the Berlin kids? What are they? You talk about things. You never know if you're equipped to be in the conversation, you know. It's like people talk about movies. They'll ask if you've seen a movie, and sometimes you didn't really see the movie. Sometimes, you know, you're flipping channels on cable. You've seen a little of the movie, you know. You've seen 5 minutes, but on cable, you see the same 5 minutes 46 times. So you think you've seen this movie, but you have not seen the movie, and you certainly shouldn't be talking to people about it on planes. That's the thing. And I don't learn this. I don't. So the guy says, "Hey, you ever see RoboCop?" And I went, "Yeah." Remember the scene where the car blows up outside the store? No, I didn't see that. When the guy and his wife walk into the restaurant? No, I didn't see that either. Well, why'd you say you saw the movie? I was trying to be your friend. That's why, sir. I was bending over backwards to try and help you out there. I just chewed my head off there. So much of life is spent in conversations you don't want to be in. Even among friends, it's just hard. You go with couples, you know, couples will go out, four people, and you think, well, this should be easy. We'll talk over dinner. Couples split up. Even couples over dinner it's too big. Four people is too much to talk. So men, usually the guys will talk, and the women will talk to themselves, and little, you know, couples. And then at the end of the evening, maybe one guy will say to the other woman, "Hey, so how are you? Everything good? Good to see you, sweetheart. Everything's good. All right, good. We'll do this again. Sure, good. It's good. It's good to do this. We should do this more." You split up. Big groups, let me go like 6 and 8 people, when like it's too many. 10 people, what happens? This is really retarded. 10 people go out to dinner, you don't even talk, because you're not human beings now. When you go out, 5 couples, every couple becomes a little team, see? Every couple is a team, and you tell stories as teams, these little tag team storytelling teams. You know, she starts, you finish, you close, you know, you correct her, she corrects you, but you finish the finish line about the same time. And whatever subject comes up, every couple has to go. Every couple has to go, we had an experience like that too. And you step forward, you tell your little piece of shit story, you know, and then you work your way around the table, and that's how you kill an evening, basically. Everybody boring the hell out of everybody. We had a thing, and you always have to huddle with your partner. "Honey, do we have anything like that we could talk about? Oh, he lost his luggage at the airport. Did we ever lose anything? Luggage, suitcase, didn't you ever lose anything? Hurry up, we're next, they're coming around. Look, hurry up! Yes, in Florida, we had a thing." Whew. I just remembered. We had a thing in Florida. And you always feel your story has to be more interesting than the last couple to go. You know what I mean? Couple one, they lost their luggage. Well, we lost our luggage and our passports. Well, that's really a story. That's good. And couple three has to beat that. We lost our luggage, our passports, and our house was stolen. Our house with our luggage. And our children. Our children were stolen. The whole family, the whole house, everything. We called American Express, we got new children the next day, but I'll tell you, two boys and a girl, it worked out fine, but the point was, we were alarmed. Every couple has to go. Every couple has to tell their, even if they have nothing. Some couples, they feel, compelled to tell, you know, step up to the plate and tell their story, and they have nothing. They go, "Well, we never lost luggage. Did we ever lose? No, we never lost luggage. I once had cufflinks I misplaced." And you're going, "That's the worst story I ever heard in my life. Why didn't he just pass? He didn't have to go. He could have passed it. Maybe he had something good next time." But everybody has to go. You always go. And if there's a terrible moment that happens. Sometimes, it's your turn. You're telling your story. You look around a table and you suddenly realize nobody is listening anymore. They're just talking to themselves. They're paying the check and they're going, "Am I the dullest man in the world? What happened here?" The only person still listening, of course, is your partner, because she, you know, and she's heard this 1,000 times. She's heard, but she doesn't have the heart to watch your story plummet like a boulder. So she's sitting there listening, and even the dumbest thing is you continue to tell her. This is really dumb. You continue to tell the one person who not only has heard this, but could care less about the story. You go, we had a thing in Florida, didn't we, honey? Then we lost the bags. That was a something. That is still talking. What happened then? What did we do? I don't. And she's right in your face going, just stop. You don't have to. Just stop. Drop. Drop it. Nobody's listening. Stop it. Stop it. We're married. You don't have to amuse me. Just stop. I was trying to amuse them, but I put them to sleep. I can't believe it. You always, because after a while, when you've been together after a while, you know each other's stories, you know, and that's what the common complaint about people who've been married 30 years, they always go, we never talk. We never talk. Well, I don't know why we never talk. You know why? My guess, you've heard this already. That's why. You go, look, when we got married, I sort of told you everything I had done up to that point. I brought you up to date. And since then, you've been there. The hell am I going to tell you? Do we have to talk? What if we just read? Couldn't we just read? Wouldn't that be good? And then we'll talk about what we've read. It'll be new. It'll be different. Couples, that's why we get married late. People get married, you know, in their 40s or something. That's the one advantage they have. They go, you know what? I got stories till we die. We're going to be fine. We're going to be fine. I got things I haven't even hinted to you about. Are you kidding? You know, I was an Olympic gymnast. I never told you that? Yeah, that's right. 72. Never told you. I thought I'd bring it up later in life. I don't know, when I got married, people, all my guy friends, the guys who are already married want to give you advice, you know? And there is no advice, really. When you get married, just good luck and don't be an asshole. That's really, you know, just the one rule you just printed on the door there. On your way out, oh, don't be an asshole. Right, thanks for reminding me. I was headed that way. But guys, see, guys like to be experts at things. So they just, all my guy friends will go, hey, let me tell you something, Bob. Before you get married, let me just tell you a few things from my experience. They could have been married 45 minutes ahead of you. But they're still the expert. They go, hey, I've been married a little bit longer than you, my friend. In fact, I got to get back to my reception. All right, now listen. Are you listening? This is very important, what I'm about to tell you. When you get married, it's different. That's the last thing you ever go, welcome back! Is it better or worse? Well, it's not better or worse, it's just different. You'll see. Good luck. And don't be an asshole. It's just, certain things will change. I don't know, for guys, I know one of the first things to go, men lose the ability to choose clothing by yourself. I don't know when it happened, but I know it happened, because I don't have it anymore. I used to. I used to get dressed by myself all the time. This was, no kidding, I would put on shirt and pants, go out in public. Other people would look, and there was no problem. Nobody was laughing. There was no chuckling behind my back. You know, the fashion police were not knocking my door down. I was fine. But do you live with a woman, you get as far as the door, and a voice goes, you're not going to wear that, are you? Tell me you're not going to wear that, because I will leave you right now. That you would even think to put those things together frightens me no end. And you go, oh, together? I wasn't gonna wear this together. Is that what you thought? No, no. You know what I was doing? I was just showing you clothing that I own currently. That's what this is. These are currently in my possession, both these items. Sort of an inventory reminder for you. I'll take them off now that you've been reminded. I don't even try anymore. I go, honey, what do you think? Just tell me, a striped shirt and a solid tie? Maybe a solid shirt and a pair of muckalucks. What do you think? I help me out. A beetle wig and a grass skirt, do you think? Or maybe a goose down vest and some sort of Viking helmet? Tell me, because I haven't used that part of my brain in 7 years. In fact, why don't you just choose something, lay it out. I'll be in the crib till we have to leave. Did you do that? You surrender. You surrender. Entire sections of your brain just go. I mean, we're all on our way to somebody's house, we're going to a party, and I'll actually say, honey, these people, do I still like them? How do we feel about them? I like them? All right, so I'll be nice, you say. All right, good. You'll tell me if I stop liking them. You say dumb, I mean, you actually, things that you used to do, you surrender. You go, you'd be in a restaurant, honey, what do I want to eat? Why wouldn't I know that? Why, I used to know these things. I ate my whole life. I got here, I'm alive. I must have just winged it, I guess. Couples start to know how they eat, you know, and they have great strategies. Ever watch couples when they've been together a while, when they're ordering in a restaurant, they have that little team strategy. Here's what we do. I got it. I got it. Oh, I got it. I got it. I got it. Do you want to hear it? Do you want to? Would you let me tell you? I got the plan. I will get the chicken. You get the salmon, and that's my plan. See, and then if mine sucks, I'm gonna eat yours, all right? That's the plan. The plan is, if mine sucks, I'm gonna eat yours. That's right. If mine sucks, I'm gonna eat yours. If yours stinks, well, then you got a problem. That's gonna be bad. No, that's... Well, nobody told you to order crap, sweetheart. That was a mistake. Live and learn, because this worked out pretty goddamn good, what I got. You get selfish. You get selfish. When your food is good, suddenly you don't want to give it up. It's like, you know, you ever go for Chinese food with friends and you split it up and you're sharing, you're watching, you know, five things in the middle and everybody's taking, helping themselves. You try to be nice, but in your head, you're always going, how many shrimps does he have so far? This fat bastard's got 14 shrimps on his plate. There's two in a fork, three in a mouth. He didn't even chew up yet. There's like 18 shrimps that I count. I got 300 snow peas and a fucking noodle here. This is unbelievable. I'm not saying, I'm just saying, I don't think that's right. I can't get in there. I can't even get a fork. The man is like a windmill. I cannot get in there. First the cuffling story and now the shrimp. We're not going out with this guy anymore, I'm telling you. But couples learn how to do that. There were great things, you know, there were little things that you learn to do well if you've been together a while, things like... Even like going to a movie, couples are better at it. That's all my point. Because couples, they know the secret, which is basically you split up the responsibility. You split it up. Couples will always split up. They go, all right, honey, look, you get out of the car and buy the tickets. I'm going to park the car. Get out. Come on. Buy the ticket. Come on. Go. Now. There's no romance. Come on. Go. Get out of the car. Go. There's no romance. Come on. Tonight we'll see a movie. Tomorrow we'll kiss. Everything has a place. And it becomes this little military operation of, you get on the ticket buyer's line, I will park the car, I'll come around the northwest corner, I'll be on the end of the ticket holder's line. I am with the ticket holders, you're the ticket buyers. Now, at 0750, the door's open, and I gotta move. My regiment is leaving. Honey, if I don't have tickets, we're dead. Get me those tickets, babe, cover me. I'm going in. Some couples don't know this. You know, people dating for the first time, they hold hands, they try and do everything together. They go, let's go, this seems to be sold out. Oh, that's sold out, whoa, of course it's sold out. Separate, split up. Come on. Everybody has a job. And then you get into the theater, it's not over. You have to get the seats. Now, my advice, and you learn this after a while, what you do is, when you walk in the theater, grab the first two seats. Doesn't matter, you don't where they are, you don't have to sit there. That's just your fallback position. Right? Now, one of you guards the fallback position with your life. The other one goes into the jungle and see if you can do any better. You look for better seats, but in case you don't find them, you still got sucky seats waiting for you. So you gotta bother people. You gotta see a guy next to a jacket. Excuse me, is that seat taken? You gotta ask him. You gotta, because is he saving it? Is he dating his clothing? You don't know. You don't always know. Sometimes a jacket and a hat. Sometimes they're nuts. You see like a jacket, a hat, shoes, pants, socks, underwear, you know, a tie clip, a belt, just everything. Every item of clothing. And at the end, there's one naked guy going, they're all coming back, yes. Yes, they're all coming back. We're a group of 12. I underdressed. Yes, I did not think this through. Do you mind? You gotta get those seats. And it's still not over, because even when you find your seats, one of you has to go out to get the popcorn. Right? Now, I do that. I'm happy to do it. But there is no moment more humiliating than coming back into that dark theater and you don't know where you're sitting now. Because you're suddenly, you're 4 years old and lost at the circus. You got your arms full of stuff, and you're near tears. Oh, honey, where'd you go? Honey, I got the gummy bears you want. Honey, sometimes you can't find her. Got to go to the front and give everybody a clear view of your face. I'm the schmuck of the universe. Honey, somebody pull me out of this hell. Honey, you bump into other guys who are just as lost. Honey, babe. No, my wife is honey. Babe, sorry, sweetheart. Sweetie. Babe. Honey, and the women are going, Alan, Mitchell, where? Honey, I'm Mitchell. Honey, Bob, where? Honey, just a cacophony of lost souls. It's pathetic. It's terrible. Just look. My advice, sit next to any woman. Doesn't matter who she is at this point. Just sit down and go, look, Mitchell is not coming back, all right? He just went into the wrong theater. I saw it. He is not coming back. Bob is with my wife. Stuart is with Bob's wife. It's all screwed up. But I'm a guy. I got popcorn. It's the same shit. Now, what happened? What did I miss so far? Which is the dancing wolf exactly? I can't. You know, you watch the movie and you settle up afterwards, that's all. Because you don't have to sit near your exact wife. You just want somebody with a knee that you could grab, you know? If the movie is scary, you want to go, ooh, you know, that's all. You ever go to a scary movie by yourself? You gotta bother strangers. You're gonna go, ooh, you know, you gotta just, excuse me, sir, this means nothing. Ooh, you know, just, of course you can still see other people. I just wanted to, I got scared. You're right there? Can you see well from there? All right. If you were any closer, you'd be me. And then what would I do? Again, I was where? You are so not helping me. Can I say that to you? I don't mean it in a bad way. You're a nice person, but you have really just not helped me here. Are we English speaking? That would be so helpful. I think a sense of a common language would just totally enhance your enjoyment for the evening, to my eye. Oh, I know what I was saying. Oh, the story. All right, watch. Watch, we'll fix it. It'll be like it never happened. The other advantage that I was going to tell you specifically, because I'm trying to help you out here, once you get married, you always have somebody to blame. Everything, if somebody invites you to a party you don't want to go to, you can always blame them. You go, you know, I'd love to, but I think my wife made plans. Yeah, I think, yeah, no, I'd love to come to your house and see 10 hours of slides. Are you kidding? I'd love that. I think she made plans. Let me check. I'm like a terrible chicken with that. I always push them. I'm like, oh, honey, you call them. Tell them we can't go. Tell them, you tell them. They're your friends. All right, they're my friends, but you met them, didn't you? So you, oh, they like you better. I'll tell you what, I'll dial and you talk to them. Is that fair? Men are very chicken. It gets spineless. When you have to be, you know, you have to be really tough and you have to be assertive. I'm not good with tough. I'm great with instructions for tough. I give great instructions for tough. If I'm not going to be around, I'm great. I go, look, honey, I got to go. But listen, when the cable guy gets here, you tell him that we are not happy with the reception. Tell him. No, let's be firm with the guy, honey. That's the problem last time. You weren't firm. I would do it, but I got to gather and hunt. But you, make sure he gets it. Because I know if I was there, I go, sir, is that the best you can get the picture? All right, you tried your best. What are you going to do? You tried. If you tried, you tried. Would you like a beer or something, buddy? Because we learn very young to get other people to do your dirty work. You're a kid, you're about to get in, you know, you're about to get your teeth kicked in at school. You go, yeah, well, my dad could beat up your dad. You know, just push it to somebody else. Just get somebody else to do your dirty work. Of course, the dads would show up and go, look, we don't have to beat each other up. That's silly, you know, just because the kids say that. But you know what? I'm pretty sure my wife can kick the shit out of your wife. You want to set something up next week? How was Tuesday? Would you like a beer or something like that, buddy? There were a lot of things. It was just pushing. We had to go. One party, I lost that. We had to go to this party that I didn't want to go. And these were like friends of third removed friends. These, I didn't even, why even tell you? This is, we had to go to this thing. And they should make cards. If you're going to get a card for somebody that you don't really care about, they should make cards that say that. You know, you're a friend of my wife's cousin. The hell with you. You know, something that says it. You know, we hardly know you. What'd you expect? Cash? You know, something like that. It's amazing the cars they do have. You go to a car store lately, there's miles of every possible occasion that would ever come up. You know, all the regular, happy birthday, happy anniversary, and you know, happy graduation, heard you bought a new house, heard you bought a new car, heard you went with the French toast. You know, every decision that you could make, they have. They celebrate. Then they break it up by different people, from the two of us to the two of you, from the three of us to the three of you, you know, from some of us to all of you. From most of us to nobody in your area. You know, they have that. Then they break it up by actual occupations. They're very specific. You know, to a wonderful boss, from a terrific secretary. You know, from a belligerent osteopath to a nifty teamster. You know, every job, every adjective, they have it. They have, as a joke, I finally said to the guy, I said, you know, there's one card I can't seem to find. A friend of mine just got a promotion on his anniversary, and the same day his anniversary, and his dog had puppies that morning, but sadly his grandfather passed away later that day. So is there a card that might cover the whole thing? And he said, sure, from the whole family or just yourself? So they had it. This is my point. They had it. And get the right card. You know, just take the time and get the appropriate card, because you ever get the card that's not exactly right, so you figure you can change it by hand and make it work? People hate when you do that. They hate it. Because you know, think, well, they won't know. And I go, look what the cheap bastard gave me. Look at that. He penciled it in, for crying out loud. Because sometimes it's close. You know, you want a dad card and they have grandfather cards. They have grandpa. So you go, well, we'll cross our grand and we'll make it pa. That's all. Huh? Happy birthday, pa. And then everybody call him pa so I don't look stupid. Right? Call him pa. How you doing, pa? Happy birthday, pa. It'll be like Bonanza. We'll have fun. All right? Call him pa. What have the little kid cost today? You're 5. You're a big boy. Well, today you're 65. How do you like that? You're 65, boy, oh boy, huh? Boy, oh boy, you're 65. This is perfect. We'll make the giraffe a set of golf clubs. He'll never know. This'll be good. His neck is a 9-iron, a little bag with hooves. They have those. I've seen them. People get petty with those cards, you know. Or you go the other way. Some people get the very extravagant, those big, huge $7 cards. You know, they're huge. The envelope is like a one-bedroom apartment. They're very, very big. I mean, to lick at clothes, you would actually dehydrate from the amount of saliva expended. They are that big. See, they're not really that big. They're kind of big. And I exaggerated it for the sake of humor. I took how big it actually was, and I fibbed for the entertainment of you. So hard. So difficult. I kid, I joke, I come from love. And you know, I come from love. It's a little town north of here called Love. I come from there. It's just one exit past Facetious. Do you know the area at all? Just it's Facetious and Love. And if you hit total hostility, you went too far. But that's where I'm from originally. So I'm looking at this catalog, let's say. Howdy, you know, who's to say I wasn't? I'm looking at this catalog, because we get every catalog in the world. I don't know what mailing list I got on, but once you buy something that you don't need, something that's stupid, they sell your names to other people who make stupid things. They go, oh, he doesn't care what he buys. Look at this, look at this. And people go, oh, we make crap too. Look at this, take some pictures, look at this. We get these, you know, these combination things they make. It's a sweater vest and a bottle opener. Wow, that's important. It's a hot water thermos and a snorkel mask. Well, you know what? We could use that. A snorkel mask and a thermos. We don't have to come up for coffee anymore. This is perfect. We can snorkel all day, never come up. Then they take things that I don't even know how they combine them. You know, it's a cassette rack and a Doberman pincher. How could that be? It's a rain bonnet, but it's also your parents. How could that be? I just saw them. They weren't a rain bonnet. See, rain bonnet and parents are so different. One is a little packet and the other two people. So how could they be? Sure. It's perfectly logical. So, the main thing with these catalogs, this is all I was going to say, and then I'll drive you home. When you get these catalogs, just throw them out, because you don't need them. No, you don't want anything that's in there. They have. I throw them all out. I throw all the catalogs. Well, Victoria's Secret I keep, because that's different. That's you can't even count that, really. Victoria's Secret, it's more than a catalog. It's a novella. It's a little novella that I keep by my bedside, and I cry myself to sleep. It's a beautiful little story. I read a few pages, and tears will actually form right there. No, there are no words, of course, but you know, it's a lingerie catalog, and there are no words, but if you use your imagination, you can put the story together. It's about a group of women. It's a slumber party organization is what it is. I don't know what the political agenda is, but they slumber every 4 to 5 months. And one of them has this great house up in Connecticut, and they go up there to slumber. But see, they're not sure what to wear, and this is where the drama comes in. This is the conflict for these gals, see? They don't know exactly what to wear, so they bring a couple of changes, see? And then they try them on. I go, what do you think? No, I'll change it. She goes away, she tries out. Another one comes out. Do you think? No. All right, she comes out. Then Jill Goodacre comes out, and I go, that's good. And then she leaves it on, you know? And another comes out. How about if I lean on a piano? Better, you know, it's all right. Just make sure there's a baby grand around when you wear that, because that's going to help you, sweetheart. But they pick something that finally they get the outfit they like, and they go to sleep. They slumber for, you know, in the middle of the book, they're sleeping, you know, they're in different slumbering positions. And towards the end of the book, that's when they're selling the sweaters and the coats and the luggage and the gloves, because they're leaving. It's the end of the story. They always have it at the end, because they're getting ready to go home. But you know they're coming back next month, because they never tell you which one is Victoria and what the hell is the secret. See, they don't tell you. So they always get you back. I'm a sucker, man. I'm one of these salesmen's dream, because somebody has to just tell me one reason why I'd be stupid not to get it, and I'll just go, okay, you got it. I'm in this store, I'm looking at this CD player, and the salesman comes over and goes, hey, how do you like that? It plays 10 albums at a time. You put in 10 discs, you don't have to change it. And I went, yeah, well, I don't need that. It's, you know, it's stupid. He says, it's 18 hours of music. I went, okay. Because, you know, I hadn't done the arithmetic. This fellow opened up my eyes, 18 hours. And so I took it home, and I realized, wait a second, I'm not up 18 hours. When would this ever come into play? 18 hours, the last four albums would be keeping me awake. This is not something I need. It's 18, you have to get up like 4 a.m. just to program this. You know, you gotta get, honey, wake up. Do you know what you wanna hear tonight about 11:30? I know it's early, but I gotta do it now. I have 18 hours. Honey, I got Springsteen, I got some Mozart, I got Jerry and the Pacemakers, and then I'm scraping bottom. I have nothing. Give me a clue. We're open till about 11. I didn't need it. You know why I got this machine? Because I wanted one more remote control unit in my life. That's why. I needed the even dozen. I want to have 12 of those suckers lined up on the coffee table, bring the friends over and go, see those? I don't know how to work any of them.
Right, 0 for 12, that's exactly right. Not one goddamn button do I understand, but they're all mine.
Because they can't, you know, have these brochures, these, you know, instruction books that they explain things, but they're so, they're, like, VCRs have 140 pages of instructions, and you look at this going, you know, the pictures look nothing like what you have in your hand. You go, I think this is instructions for a toaster. This can't be right. This is slices. That can't be right. You know, and they try and make it easy. They have these cartoons now. They're making these little stick figure simpletons, you know, these little round heads with no neck and three thumbs, and they can do it. And you feel like a total jackass. You know, you go, look at this. This guy put it together. He's got no torso. How did he do that? I got like 10 things that I don't know how to work. I own them, but I don't know how they, I just, and it's embarrassing, you know, because, you know, my, you know, somebody will go, hey, did you tape that show? I go, yeah, but I don't know how to watch it. I can't get the thing out there. I'm still figuring out my answering machine. Have you called this month, by the way? Because it's flashing. Somebody has called, but it won't tell me who. It wasn't you. I'm asking everybody. You got to take a week out of your life at some point and just read instruction books. Just catch up and understand all the things that we've accumulated, because just one thing at a time, you know, every day. Today, I'm just learning one-touch record. That's all I'm going to do today. And then at the end of the week, you'll go back more prepared for your life, because they keep coming up with new things that nobody wants. Nobody asks for these things. They think we want one-touch record and freeze-frame search and split-screen pictures and 14-day timers. You know, they think we want cameras that talk and clocks that make coffee. We don't want that. We, you know what we want? We just want to lie down for a second. That's really what we want. Can you make something that would help us? Yeah, if we could lie down for like a half an hour, I would be so happy. I've been reading instructions since 1987. My head is pounding. I cannot do it. I want to write a letter. Dear Japan, stop! We're fine. This is plenty of shit. We're fine. Stop with the VCRs. Work on diseases. Do something else. This is fine. We're all good. They have... Because there's no room in your brain. I think at a certain point in life, your brain just goes, thank you, no more calls. We have a winner, no more. No more information will get into this brain. Even phone numbers. If a friend of mine moves, I go, I'll never call you. I'm telling you right now, I'll never call you. There's too many numbers in my head. They just changed my bank access number and I'm dizzy. I can't learn it. Even information, if I call them for information, it's only 7 digits. I can't memorize it. I got to split it with the person in the room with me. Because it's too much. I go, what is it? 384, 384, that's yours. Like, what is it? 6254, 6254, 6254. Okay, what is yours, huh? You forgot? How did you, I just gave it to you. How did you, oh, operator, can I have it again, please? No, I have mine. My friend's a fucking idiot. That's what happened. Do it myself. If there's a pattern in the number, maybe I have a shot. You know, if there's, you know, a couple of patterns or maybe a pair, if there's a pair or two in there, I have a shot. You know, 382-5588. Well, give me it again. Maybe I can get it. Just tell me slowly. Just the pattern, a couple of pairs. Sometimes you get a straight flush and you're thrilled. You ever get those? They're rare, but hey, give me a call. 234-5678. I'll call you every day. Oh, that's just a gorgeous, gorgeous number. I'm gonna call you 5 or 6 times in the afternoon. In fact, hang up right now. I want to call you again. Just to use it. That's beautiful. It doesn't always work out that well. Sometimes you move and they give you a lousy number. You have no choice. You go, oh, that's crap. Look at that. Look what they gave us. Nobody will call us. Nobody will ever call us. Would you call? I wouldn't call. That's a crappy number. Why even have a phone with a number like this? Seriously. I'd rather move again and take our chances, because that's crap. You want a good number. You try and people find maybe there's a pattern on the keypad. You know, it's like, ooh, it's a little square. It's a little square. It's 2-1. It's a square. It's a little Z. It's Zorro and then a hat. It's a little couch and an ottoman. That's what it is. It's ottoman, couch, hat. That's me. Or you spell it out. People spell it out even if it makes no sense. They just want to have some kind of identity. Hey, give me a call. You can't forget it. It's 212 Sidge Blixvicum. What? What is, what? Sidge Blixvicum. Just like SB and a silent H, just like it sounds. Sage Blakes for come. Or sometimes you get, oh, Snoopy 5, that's cute, you know. But even if it works out cute, your friends are embarrassed to use it, because, you know, they got to tell the operator that's collect call to Inky Dinky Doo. Would you mind very much? Yes, yeah, person to person, 213, Yippie Kaye O Kaye. Would you mind? They try to make it easy. They have, now I got the phone, you know, with the 10 buttons. You can put in the 10. It sounded like a great idea. The 10 most commonly used numbers, you put them in there, and then one touch of a button, you got these people, and these are now the most important people in your life, your friends, your family, one touch. Problem is, they go into the phone and they're out of your head for the rest of your life. I cannot call these people unless I'm at my desk. I gotta, you know, and these are important people. You'll be out and go, you know, I gotta call my parents, but first I gotta drive home. I don't know what the hell it is. I know it's the second one down on the left, but they don't have that here. I asked them, it's different. They have their own stuff. It goes in there, and now my phone has memory and I don't. This is very sad. It goes in there. What's scary is, once it goes in there, there's a little hole in your brain where that was. There's a little space. Little space, and the next thing that you hear takes its place. So you walk, and you don't realize there is garbage information out there. We hear things, you know, you're watching TV, you're reading The Enquirer, and things just seep in there. You don't even know it. I was at a party, I actually heard myself tell someone, you know, when she was in high school, Vanna White played the lead in Brigadoon. What did I just tell you? What did I say? Vanna, how the hell would I know that? How did that used to be my sister's home number, son of a bitch. I'll never get it out of there. So I got the phone thing. I don't know how to work. Even like big things that I should know how to work, it's scary that I don't. This electrician came over. First question, he said, Mr. Reiser, where's your main power supply? I went, poof, you got me there. That's a good one. Probably outside. Did you look? Is it outside? I think I saw it outside earlier. No?
I don't really know what it looks like. I was kidding. What is it, a big thing?
Maybe it's inside. It's either inside or outside. I know that. I don't want to think, what you think I'm stupid. It's inside or outside. It's definitely not in the doorway frame itself. I looked. Why don't you just find it? That'll be your first little job. All right, you find it and I'll have it. That'll be what I do. See, and you find it and you do certain things with wires that you understand, and then I'll give you more money than you deserve. Is that fair? Everybody with their own little job. That's how we'll do it. Because you're at their mercy. If you don't know what you're doing in your house, you're at their mercy. And things come up that you don't even know. We had in the backyard, we had this snake. Not a big snake, you know, but enough to make me pass out, all right? So this snake came. So I called the snake guy. Snake man. It was his name. Snake man. Big truck. Snake man. Little snake in the picture. And I said, we have a snake. Go find it. You'll see. So I don't know where it is. I think it's right near the power supply. So he comes back, he says, listen, you're okay. These snakes are good because they scare away mice. They eat mice, so they'll scare away any kind of field mice. So you want these kind of snakes. And I went, okay, just explain it to me and I feel better. So now I have snakes that scare away mice. I don't know how I'm gonna scare away the snakes. This is my problem. I gotta get an aardvark now to scare away the snakes. Then I gotta get a gazelle. I don't know what I gotta do. I just keep getting bigger and bigger animals until everybody's too scared to show up. I don't know how to work it. And it will never end. This will never end. I'll come home someday, there'll be a hippo, you know, in the middle of the living room. Don't worry, honey, they scare away the bison. We're fine. You notice there are no bison around today? The hippo scared him pretty goddamn good. You know, a hippo man was here today, he explained me the whole thing. $45, we're bison free for a year.
You learn these little animal things. We have no bison. I learned something. A friend of mine took me fishing, and I had never really, you know, like real fishing on the ocean kind of fish. Because I grew up in New York, you fish, you know, you don't catch things you're actually happy to have. You know, you fish in New York, you get like, you know, a snow tire and a union organizer, you know. You don't... Nothing that you would actually slice up with lemon and serve to buddies, you know. It's just... But we had a great time. It was actually fun. I enjoyed it. The only thing that bothered me was that we tease the fish, because we dangle worms, which they like. They think they're getting a snack. They're not getting a snack, they're getting death. You know, we should tell them that. You'll be dying, I'll be killing you. Go, I'll give you a head start. You know, I got a boat. One Mississippi, two me. No, give me a head start. But we you know, we advertise worms and go, hey, you know what? We're all out of worms. How about a big hook through your mouth? Would you like that instead? That's the ultimate bait and switch. That's what that is there. But in all fairness, they deserve it. Fish deserve it because they're so stupid. They're so dumb. I don't fish in a family. I don't mean to insult, but they are truly stupid. How many years have we been fishing? A zillion years? They don't catch on. It just takes one smart fish to see the worm and go, wait a second. Worms don't traditionally dangle for no reason. There must be some reason. Hey! Oh, put somebody's eye out, for Christ's sake. They're so dumb. They line up, they see their friends getting yanked out of the water, and they go, hey, I'm next. Now, honey, don't worry, that won't happen to me. I know what I'm doing. He ordered wrong. He ordered badly. I'll have a worm, please. Wow! They don't learn. They're in schools, but they're not learning. You see what I'm saying? Oh, stop. I don't even charge you for that one. I throw it in, you take it home. Wrap it up. It's good for weeks. To me, funny. To you, less. So, these fish, they don't catch on. It's just they're not grasping. They don't see that whole pattern. Worm death. I would catch on. If I went to a restaurant and every time I ordered fruit cup, somebody dropped an anvil on my head, you would begin to notice after a while. You go, fruit cup death. You know what? I'm going to get the soup instead. Or get what you want and then get out of the way. I'll have the fruit cup and slide over. Get out of there. They don't learn, so they get that hook that... My friend said, don't worry about the hook. They don't feel that. That's what people who fish, they don't feel that. Fish do not feel the hook. I said, come on, it's a little mouth. It's a huge hook. How could they miss it? It's a huge... They don't feel it. I'm telling you, we've done the research. They don't feel it. I'm sure animals say the same things about us. You go into the woods, you hear grizzly bears going, hey, you know when you bite their arms off? They don't feel it. They don't feel it. Believe me, if I thought they felt it, I would never do it. I couldn't do it. I couldn't live with myself. No, you're helping them. You know when they yell like that? That's a dance of joy. That's what that is. They're saying, yippee, yippee. They're saying, yippee. They're saying, thank you for trimming that section of me. Because they shed that naturally. Every 6 months, they shed that part of their own. That's why they have the short sleeve shirts. Six every in the summer. Yes, they trim it. They do like to trim it. We only care about killing animals. It's funny. Americans only get upset about killing animals if they're cute. When they're cute, we suddenly go, oh, you can't do that. How could you kill an animal? It's like dolphins. Why do we find people got upset because they were accidentally killing dolphins in the tuna nets? And everybody, well, you can't kill dolphins, which is why you shouldn't kill dolphins. But my question is, how come we didn't get upset about 10,000 dead tunas? Right there, little ugly tunas on the same boat. They're just piled up going, get this crate off my eye, please. Ow! You know, biting each other in the ass. But everyone's going, oh, look at a little dolphin we got by accident. Look at that. You guys, we meant to kill. This was an accident. They're cute. That's what dolphins have, that great face. You know, this round with the smile, the friendly eyes, a little bald head. You know, they look like your Uncle Murray. You know, we can't slaughter anything that might show up for the holidays. That's our rule of thumb here. Well, we have, and like in the Orient, you know, in the Far East, they eat dogs. People in the Orient, they kill, they eat dogs. And we heard that, and we got, oh, do you eat dogs? Oh, that's disgusting. How could you, are uncivilized, you were barbarians, how could you eat a dog? They're cute. But a chicken, you know what? Cut it up, put it in a bucket, we'll eat it in the car. Seriously. Whew, is that ugly. With a triangle on the head thing, what is that? Oh, no kidding, that is ugly. Teach him a lesson. But put that puppy down. How could you kill a puppy? It's so cute. But a lobster, boil it alive. Seriously, drop it in the water. Let him see why. Because he is so ugly. No, learn a lesson. Fix yourself up nice, like the Labrador. Look at him. Well, you can fix, like, do wonderful work with those things now. Fix yourself up. That's right. They do wonderful work with those things. Say, it's like fur. People, you know, how many years have we been killing animals for fur? Trillions of years. When people finally realized, hey, they're cute. You can't kill animals for fur. They, you know, seals are cute. Rabbits, minks, foxes, they're cute. I don't think anybody would be upset if you showed up with a nice full-length rat coat. Nobody would care. Nice double-breasted weasel jacket. Nobody's complaining. Well, hey, rats are animals too. Yeah, but they're so ugly. Who's going to miss them? You know what I mean? But we make up rules. We make up rules when we, whatever suits us. You know, we make them up to please ourselves. You know why? Because we're selfish, basically. We're all self-centered. Everybody is. Don't you think? Well, who cares about you? I'm self-centered. That's really all I'm concerned with, to tell you the truth. No, we are. We're all selfish and thing is, it comes up at different times in our life. You know what I mean? We all want to think we're nice. We all try to be nice. But there's an ugliness that finds itself and it comes out of you at different times. Usually when you're stuck in traffic, it comes out. When you're stuck, you hate everybody. You're sitting there going, oh, man, I just hate everybody. I'm going to have to kill most of these people. I've had terrible thoughts. I was sitting there going, you know, if there was an earthquake and half these people died, I would be home already. I would be there. It's all about you. Go! Just go! You see I'm here. Why wouldn't you go? If you just go, there wouldn't be traffic. That's why there's traffic. Your failure to go. You always want to get there fast. Doesn't matter where you're going. You could be on your way to the dentist to get raw nerves sucked out of your jaw. And you'll still be going, go! I'm going to miss the whole nerve sucking now. Go! We're never nice. Oh, the only time we're nice is if an ambulance has to get through. Yeah, but this is amazing. People that you've been swearing at and shooting at will separate for an ambulance. Like, okay, come on, let this guy through. Come on, come on, come on. This guy has a problem. Let him through. And for a brief shining moment, peace and harmony prevails. And then it's a mad rush for that ambulance wake. Everybody wants to get behind that wake. There, I saw it first, you son of a bitch. Come on, I pulled over first, I get the wake. That's how it works. Read the manual. Just sitting there and you hate everybody. The guy in front of you, you really hate, because somehow he bears the brunt of all your hostility. Just go, oh, this guy is the whole reason. Man, I'm going to get out of the car and slap him in the head in 2 seconds. If I stare at that Garfield cat one more minute, I will get out, just pull his ears and just start twisting. I will do that. Because, you know, if he would go, they would all go. It's all his fault. And you start obsessing. You're staring at this guy's ass for half an hour, and you obsess. If I could be where he is, I would be so happy. That's all I want. If I could just be where he is, I would never ask for anything again. And of course, you get to his spot. Are you happy? No, look where he is now, this lucky son of a bitch. Look at him. He's doing so much better than me. All these people are doing better than me. Then you turn around and go, yeah, well, at least I'm ahead of these losers. We just want to be better off than somebody. Well, I'm doing better off than them, so I'm all right. And that's when you calm down. Once you realize you're in it, you calm down, and you look at the cars next to you. You always have those little sympathetic sighs, those... Can you believe this? It sucks, doesn't it? How's it over there? It sucks? Sucks here, too. Everything sucks, so I'm not so bad now. Everybody's all right. So nobody's happy. Well, this is okay, then. This is all good. But you're in it together, and you have this relationship, which is why I get so upset. I get personally offended when somebody tries to pass. Because it's like they're breaking up with me. I'm going, where you going? Hey. Where you going? We all agreed. We get there late. Where you going? What, you want to see other cars? Oh, I guess you need some space of your own. All right, well, good luck, and I hope it works out. You don't hope it works out. You hate this guy. You hate this guy, and the best moment in the world is 2 minutes later when he comes crawling back into your lane. And you don't let him in. You're scorned now. You go, hey, look who's back. I guess life in a fast lane didn't work out like you planned. Oh, suddenly I'm looking good to you, huh? Still looking for a space? Yeah, about a mile and a half back I saw a space, asshole. Why don't you see if that's still there? We get selfish. We're all, you know... Even that's the whole thing with men and women. That's the whole point. This is watch how this comes full circle before your very eyes. The whole reason men and women get together in the first place is not out of love, it's not to have children, it's because we're selfish and men can do certain things, you see, and women can do certain things. And if you get together, everything will get done. And that's really what you want. You want a house there where whatever comes up, somebody is good at that. That's all you want. Because women, I mean, stupid thing, little thing, not even sexual things. Like, you ever catch a sweater on a hook and you get the thread that hangs out? Women learned that's not a big deal. Women in their lives, they learned to go, you know what, you pull it through, you tie a new knot, and you got a sweater in like 12 seconds. They got a brochure as youngsters that explain this. I don't know. Men did not get this. Men will just stare at that for an hour and a half. Go, oh, look at that. Look at that. Just now. Just by call, look at that. I got to throw it out now. This is no good. On the other hand, men know how to connect speakers to stereo. So it's a trade-off. They see women don't get involved with stereo equipment. They can, obviously. They just choose not to. And they make us feel better. They go, honey, could you put the speakers up? And most guys would go, shh, that's the only thing I can do. Sure, okay. Well, look what I did on the speaker. Look at that. Get together and everything's taken care of. Well, you know, that's why men and women get together. It's not always sex. You know, here's the thing. I'll share this with you because you're here. Here's the thing. You know what ruined sex for a lot of guys? This woman right here. I hate to say it. No, I kid. I joke. I come from love. No, here's what ruined sex for a lot of people. The letters to Penthouse magazine, truthfully. Really, you ever read the letters in Penthouse? I never did, but a friend of mine told me what they have. They have these letters written by presumably normal people like ourselves. We read these and we go, where does this happen? I've never heard of anything like this. I've picked up hitchhikers. They just get out of the car when they're there. I never spoke to them again. And all these boasting figures. You know, I've never considered myself big, but at 11 inches, come on! 11, my leg is 11. You know, what are we talking about? And they lie, but see, what they don't realize, I want these letters to be true. I'm rooting for them. And if it doesn't sound true, I'll bend the truth. I'll work around it. I'll give them the benefit of the doubt. You know, because they start off very normal. I went down to get the mail, and to my surprise, the regular mailman was replaced by a beautiful blonde woman. Okay, that's not crazy. Women deliver the mail. She was blonde. Why not? Maybe he lived in Milwaukee, heavy Scandinavian population. Sure. It was a hot day. I offered her a drink. She came inside and took off her shirt. Okay, that's not crazy. Why not? You know, it's hot. You get that sticky shirt thing. She didn't want to sit on the fabric. All right. So far, he's not lying. We had a few drinks. Suddenly, one thing led to another, and we were all over each other. I was here. We were touching. We were biting. We were rubbing. We were moving. Suddenly, my neighbor comes in, and she gets in the action, too. All right. So that, you know, she was concerned. The neighbor was concerned. She heard the furniture being tossed about. She was alarmed. She comes in. They're naked. She's dressed. She's embarrassed. So she strips down. She gets right in it. All right, so the three of us. So far, he's not lying. We're touching. We're moving. We're biting. We're rubbing. Suddenly, my neighbor's, you know, the cheerleader squad comes by. All right, so the 15 of them. So the 17 of us. We're moving. We're rolling. We're biting. We're touching. There are arms. There are legs. We're moving. And then the last line, they got to blow it. After 9 hours, we took a shower and we did it again. No, you didn't. No, you didn't. Just be honest. After 9 hours, I had a heart attack. I almost died. Well, sure. Look what you're trying to do, you silly bastard. That's too much. Just be honest. Just be honest. That's all. Listen, thanks so much for coming down, folks. Thank you. Good night.